Put your hands together for Reverend Elder Maxine, preaching, writing, author in her own right, Maxine Walker. Come on, you can do better than that as she comes.
All praise is due to an almighty God who is certainly the head of my life. I don't take your presence for granted, and I just would not pass up the opportunity to welcome my brother, who I love so very much, into this house. And I am so expectant of the word that God is going to give him. It is so important. We say we want marketplace ministry. This is it. This is it, you all. And we have to do more of it. So to God be the glory for each of you in attendance. And I just praise God for this opportunity. Now, welcome my brother, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan.
Thank you, Reverend Walker. In the name of Almighty God, whom we refer to as Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, we give him praise and thanks for his mercy, his goodness to the members of the human family. That whenever any member of that family strays from his path and loses his divine favor, before he punishes, he always raises from among that people a prophet or a messenger to whom he gives what is called divine revelation or scripture. We thank him for Moses and the Torah, or the Old Testament. We thank him for Jesus and the Gospel. We thank him for Muhammad and the Quran. Peace be upon these worthy servants of Almighty God, Allah. I am a student of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and what I will share with you tonight is from his teaching to me, which embraces the Torah, the Gospel, the Quran, all three of the books of God that represent three members of the monotheistic family of Abraham, Jews, Christians, and Muslims. Unfortunately, the family is divided. Unfortunately, Satan has put hatred among the members of a family which Abraham would be hurt over, and God is certainly displeased that if we could unite Muslims, Christians, and Jews who believe in the oneness of God, who believe in Jesus, the Messiah, who believe in all of the scriptures brought by the prophets of God, we could defeat Satan, and the kingdom would be right here on this earth with us. Please be seated. I greet all of you, my dear brothers and sisters, with the greeting words of peace. Assalamu alaikum. To the apostle whose house we are honored to be in. To the members of the clergy that serve here, and to the members of the clergy who are present tonight. to Reverend Maxine Walker, whom we honor this evening, and to all of the brothers and sisters who are present, I'm very, very honored to have this opportunity to share a few words with you. Reverend Maxine Walker has been a very dear friend of mine for the last maybe 25 years. I have always wanted to form a bond, a relationship with the Christian community and the Christian clergy, because I think we misunderstand each other, and by not dialoguing with each other, Satan makes us think we are all different, when in reality the root of all of us is the same. And so through the good office of Reverend Maxine Walker, she was instrumental in bringing really several hundred ministers over a period of time that we could meet, we could converse, we could dialogue, we could ask each other questions, and in a spirit of love and brotherhood, we made great connections. Without those connections, the Million Man March would not have been a reality. Without Christian unity and the love of us for each other, the Million Man March would not have been. So I'm honored to be here tonight to share words, but to pray to Almighty God that He will give time and more life to our sister, that she may continue to do the good work that she does, which is bringing people together. The theme. The theme of her many meetings like this is called Sista to Sister. I failed to ask Reverend Walker, what was she thinking when she gave this event that title? So since I didn't ask her and didn't get her answer, I began to think on it myself. And I saw a lot in the title, Sista to Sister. Sista seems to be Ebonic, which sort of represents a black woman who is not quite what she should be. But sister is different from Sista, but Sista too is moving to or toward becoming sister. Now, how could you be a sister if you didn't recognize a common father? So, Apostle says the kingdom has come. But that's a part of a prayer that the disciples asked Jesus, tell us, teach us how to pray. And Jesus said, pray on this wise, our Father. Stop right there. See, Sista lost her connection to the Father. But sister has a connection to the Father, but the Sista who has lost her way is moving toward her sister who's reintroducing her to the Father. So until we recognize the Father, we cannot consider ourselves sisters or brothers, because it is the Father who makes us brother, sister, and family. Now, that brings us to the value of a woman. This is a world that does not value the female. She's looked upon more like a plaything than the serious creation that Almighty God intended for her to be. And the sad thing about Sista is she doesn't recognize her value. So she plays into Satan's game of degenerating the female and making her to see herself only as an object of pleasure. And so the enemy undresses her. For the enemy wants her to use the beauty of her form to attract the natural lust in a man, to keep his mind focused below the navel in the underworld, so he can never see the value of her and climb to the heavenly part of his natural existence. So the moment you lower a woman, you automatically lower the man. The moment you elevate the woman, you elevate the man. How is that so? My teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, said, "Where there are no decent women, there are no decent men for the woman." And the black woman in particular is the mother of civilization. Now, I would like to just take a journey with you for just a few minutes to help Sista to see the value of being a sister as a child of God. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth, he did 5 days of magnificent work. And on the sixth day, he created a man. The Bible says that there was no tiller of the ground. So God evidently created the man to do some heavy work. Tilling the ground is an act of cultivation. Everything that God created was already here, but now he wanted to make a man as not a glory of God, but the glory of God. This is very powerful to attempt to understand. The sun is a glory. The moon is a glory. The mountains, the seas, the rivers, the lakes, the birds, the bees, the fowl, the fish, these are glorious of God, and they glorify God, but the glory of God, the glory, the definite article when it is used, sets that thing apart from everything else that is a, because this is the. And the Bible didn't give that position, the glory, to man alone. Because in the act of creation, if you study the scripture carefully, there were two people made at the same time. male and female, created he them and called their name Adam. So Adam is not a man. Adam represents the beginning of the human community. The Quran says it a little differently, but it's a very beautiful scripture, which I'll quote to you. It says, keep your duty to Allah as it ought to be kept. It says, for he created you from a single essence, and from that same essence created his mate. Now, if that single essence is God himself, which it is, then male and female are direct descendants of the Creator. I want you to please hear me. You're not just somebody. You are direct descendants of him who originated the heavens and the earth. And you are not black because you're cursed. You are black because you are the original creation of the Creator. Now follow me, because this is not racism. This is just actual facts. Two Caucasian people cannot produce a yellow man, much less a brown man, not to think of a black man. But from the black, the Bible tells you, from one blood, come on now, came all of the nations. Well, blood is the life fluid of some creature. That creature, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said to us, is the original man, the first man that God created. He's a black man. And that's why when these anthropologists go searching for the origin of man, they go to Africa, not Europe. Talk to me. And they keep going back to Africa, finding bones older and older and older of black man. The first woman, they call her Eve. But when Newsweek magazine wanted to depict Adam, they depicted Adam as a man of color. And they depicted Eve as the mother of all humanity as a black woman. The world knows this. You shouldn't be ashamed then to claim who you are, sister. You are a direct descendant of God himself. And in you is him. His essence is a part of the male and the female. But Satan, as he caused the fall of Adam, has caused the fall of male and female, and we are no longer what God intended for us to be. He created man and woman in his image and after his likeness, and gave the man and woman power and dominion. We're not exercising that right now. Why? Because we are not what he created us to be. We have fallen from the high level that the Creator created us in, and we are on the level of the beasts of the field. How did we fall like this? Because Satan interfered with our relationship with our Creator. Brothers and sisters, it's wonderful to sing the glorious songs of praise. It's wonderful to preach the words of praise. But Jesus didn't come into this world for us only to sing the words of praise or preach the words of praise. He came to bring us back to our original position with God as a God ourselves. What? Now, Farrakhan, I think you're stretching things a little bit. No. David the psalmist said, "Ye are all God's children of the Most High God." Well, if you are a God and I am a God, and she is a God and I am a God, and we are gods from the God, then Satan's job is to disconnect the children from the Father so that the wisdom, the power, the spirit of the Father won't be seen in his children. Now take a look at our people. Look at the condition of our people. See what we're doing to ourselves and what we're doing to one another. Regardless to our songs of praise, we act contrary to what we sing about. We act contrary to what we preach about. So we are really, if I pardon the expression, I don't mean to hurt any feelings. I start with ourselves. We are hypocritical to what we say, because we are not living the life that brings the kingdom into reality. Sister to sister. Now, Jesus came into the world for a very special purpose. From our vantage point, and I think it's your vantage point too, because man had fallen so low, so far from himself, that he needed a redeemer. He needed a savior. He needed someone to reconnect fallen humanity back to God so that we could once again reflect God. The people walked in darkness, gross darkness, the people. But upon them hath the light shined. Now, my dear sisters, we can't teach a subject like this unless we understand what the slave master's vision was when he brought our fathers across the Atlantic Ocean to be made slaves. He never intended for us to reflect the Creator. He wanted to take the place of our Father and become our master. So when you beat fear into a people and make them call you massa, and then they're afraid to disobey you, then you can shape them and mold them in the way you want them to be. You can't blame the clay. You got to look at the potter. Who made us into this grotesque being that we have become? That we are now the number one killers of ourselves, destroyers of each other, disrespecters of our women, disrespecters of our mothers. Most of my sisters in here have children, but very few have a good family life where there's a male, a female, and children. You are in this thing almost by yourself. And nature brings male and female together. Nature makes us procreate, but then if the man runs away from his responsibility, then you are left alone with the burden of rearing your children, but robbed of the knowledge of how to do it. The Bible says, train up the child in the way it should go, and when it is old, it will not depart from that way. Well, what is the way that the child should go? How can you train the child up in that way if you're not sure that you know the way? And it was not the slave master's desire that you should know how to train your children in the way that they should go. He wanted us to train the children to be better tools of service for his purposes. As a result of that, the black male had to be destroyed, and the black female had to be remade to bring into this world children that would look up to, follow, and almost worship the slave master and his children. That's a fact. Religion has been helpful to us. But the enemy has taken our love for Jesus Christ and turned us into subtle worshipers of himself. He painted the Lord in his image. We don't have any problem if Jesus is Caucasian. We don't care nothing about that. We know he's one that we should follow and submit to, regardless of color. But Jesus happened to be black. I saying this. He said it. What? Jesus said, I am the seed of David, the root of Jesse, the bright and the morning star. David's father was Jesse. David's son was Solomon. Solomon said, I am black but comely, O ye daughters of Jerusalem. Well, if he's black, daddy could not have been something else. So if Jesus had hair like what? Have you ever felt this lately before you fixed it? Like lamb's wool. And he had feet like burnished brass. His mother Mary was an Egyptian. Egypt is in Africa. And even though Jesus taught in Palestine, she took her baby and fled into Egypt that the scripture might be fulfilled. Out of Egypt have I called my son. Come on now. So, Sista has been ruined. And it takes the coming of God and the reintroduction to his Christ that will bring us back to where God wanted us to be. Now let's go back 2,000 years a moment. You see all the movies of Jesus? They got a lot of them out there. They got his mother Mary. They got Martha. Right? And another Mary. How were those women dressed around Jesus? Did you see any of them with a miniskirt? Come on now. You didn't. You didn't see none of those sisters with hot pants on. Come on now. You didn't, did you? Why? Because Jesus knew the value of a female. And he knew he couldn't build the kingdom with naked women, and men can't think anymore to build a kingdom because they're looking at your finery, Sista. But we want to move Sista to sister, a child of God. Now, I don't want to say this in a way that makes you think I'm talking down to you, because I am in love with you. And when you love your people, you want to see your people better than what the enemy made of them. You want them made again in the image and the likeness of God. So Paul said, be ye not conformed to this world, but be ye what?
Transformed.
By what? Well, why must your mind be renewed? Because our minds were made by the slave master and his children into this grotesque shape. And if you really study our people, we're beautiful on the inside, if you can get there. Yeah, but you know, you really got to be a miner, M-I-N-E-R, to mine out the good that's sitting up in us. But hell is at the surface. Heaven is deep down. And that's why Jesus said, the kingdom, where is it? Within you. Well, how come with so much hell everywhere if the kingdom is in us? Because it takes the spirit of a redeemer to be patient with our people as you teach them and bring them up from the condition that they are in to the condition that God wants to make them. See, God wants to make our women, listen to me good, the mothers of that kingdom. That kingdom cannot come through men. It comes through women. It was women around Jesus at the end. The disciples had run away, except John. Peter was, I don't know that man. I had never seen that man before. You know how Negroes are. They're in love with you until the enemy comes. And when the enemy get a hold of a righteous man and wants to speak evil of him, bring him before their courts of law, child, I don't know. All you got to do is indict a black person and the rest of them fly. You don't know whether they're guilty or not. Child, did you hear the news tonight? So-and-so was indicted. Well, that's just a charge. It doesn't mean that they're guilty, but all the enemy has to do is indict us and we run from one another. So they indicted Jesus. They charged a good man because he was bringing in a kingdom that was not of what? This world. Not of this world. So how could we praise the kingdom with one foot in the world? Come on, baby, let's get down. Shake it up, baby. Talking to your little girl. Come on, get it, baby, get it. What are you making? The enemy has really made it hard for the Redeemer. You say, he paid the price for us. He did.
But don't you think that he paid the price and we can still act the fool and won't get punished for it? He paid the price, opened the way for us to go back to our original position with God as his image, his likeness, his khalifa in Arabic, which means one who stands in the place of God. Jesus stands in the place of God. And he said that where I am, you may be also. That don't mean he's flying away and we're going to get up there. It means that he's on a plane at the right hand of him, boy, with wisdom and power over everything. And he's calling us to our place beside him. Excuse me for getting a little excited. I want to close this. Look, family, the Quran, if I may quote it, it says, keep your duty to God as it ought to be kept, by whom you demand of one another your rights. Did you know that the female has rights over the male, and her nature makes a demand on him? And I don't care if you don't know your nature. Your nature is driving you to make a demand on any man that comes into your life. And you know why he's running from you? Because the demand is so strong. And he's so weak that your demand crushes him. Now, what is your demand? The Quran says, and men are the protectors and the maintainers of women. This is what God has set forth. Look at the order that Paul talks about and how that order has been interfered with. It's God, Christ, man, woman, child. That's the order. God first, Christ, man, woman, child. That's the order. Now, the worst thing that Satan has done is interfere with the divine order. There ain't no woman here looking to no man, because the man is not looking to God. How can we demand something from a woman when God is not making a demand on us that we're willing to obey? Oh, man, this is something. So when you get caught up with a man, sister, and most of y'all got caught up with somebody, okay, maybe he's good, and I know he got the potential for sure. But now, you got caught up with him, but you didn't understand your nature. See, when a man tills the ground, that's what God brought him here for. God brought him here to work hard, to be a producer. When a man is a producer, working hard, tilling the ground, bringing something up out of it that he can maintain his wife, protect her, and feed his family. A woman love a man like that. Now, sister, you working hard today because the man don't have a job. And if he got one, he making less than you. So all of a sudden now, your voice in the house is bigger than his. Talk to me. The order has been interfered with. God, Christ, man, woman. No, no, it's God, woman. God, Christ, woman, maybe a man somewhere in that equation. The Bible says, children are their oppressors and women rule over them. The order has been destroyed by Satan. And if you ever read, I'm just going to throw this at you, but I don't have time to go into it. But if you ever read Willie Lynch and what Willie Lynch, who was a slave master on the island of Jamaica, what Willie Lynch did, he broke the man in the presence of the woman, put fear in the woman for his evil against her man, and made the woman so protective of her male children that she made them weak and her females strong. And now you got girls that are strong and boys that are weak. Because your love for your male child, particularly in the South, when that boy showed some get up, you said, get up. Get on up north. You got an uncle in Chicago. Go on up there, boy. Because if you stay down here, you're going to get killed and you're going to get us killed. Get out of here. So he didn't feel like he should challenge the enemy. For his own safety, you protected him, but you protected him from the wrath that you knew was in the slave master's children, but it made him weak to challenge him. And today it's you, black woman, on the battlefield and the man waiting to walk behind you. That's why you can't honor a man. That's why you can't respect a man, because he's not your protector. He's not your maintainer. He's been destroyed by the enemy. That's why Christ needs to be real in your life. Not just talk about it, but if he's real in your life, you become a man. A real man, not a punk man. When you become a real man, then you start becoming an image of God. And the woman then want to console you. You didn't hear me. She wants to comfort you. That's just her nature. When that man tilled the ground, he was worthy to be consoled. This beautiful little girl, the daughter of our pastor, see the beauty of her leaning on her father and the tender love that she has for dad. See, you grow up like that, innocent and beautiful, leaning on the breast of the male guide and protector and maintainer in that house. And that pastor of that precious daughter wants the right man for that child. And he worries like I worry. Lord, what kind of man will come into my child's life? And he and I and we as men got to go get busy making men for God so that she will never walk in the path of those that walked before her. Now, a man has a demand on you. If a man works hard, listen to me good now, and he's a protector, and he's a maintainer, what does he expect? He don't expect television to console him. He don't expect to put on the music box and that consoles him. No, his consolation is in you. When you are happy with a man, woo. Brothers, brothers, brothers. When she is happy with us, you ain't got to ask her, get up, baby, and cook something for me. But today, she don't know how to cook, poor thing. She run to the freezer and get something made in some strange kitchen and pop it in the microwave and kill you. But grandma, go back and look at grandma, grandpa in the South. That man was out there tilling the ground. That man was out there working hard. And when he was coming home, he could smell the biscuits. 50 yards from the house, he knew his wife was cooking. Come on in, baby. How you feel, honey? He was so happy to get home because she made a home for him. She consoled him with the meal that she cooked. She consoled him with the touch of her hands. She consoled him with the warmth of her breast. She consoled that man. That's your nature. But a man has to be worthy of that. A man that ain't doing nothing don't deserve nothing. Now listen. Now here's a man wanting comfort from you, but ain't doing nothing for you. And you don't want to give him nothing because he haven't earned nothing. And after a while, love becomes painful. Oh, all right. Get him. Excuse me. Sista. We have to move toward being sister. And I want to just describe the woman of God for you. See, the woman of God, she don't get her blessings necessarily through a man, although that would be nice. But because the world is so messed up, the woman has to find a direct relationship with God. Men, if they were naturally in their right order, they would be wonderful spiritual teachers in their home. And the woman could look to her husband as a teacher, as a guide. Poor fella today, poor us. Sisters going to college, brothers in the street. Sister becoming a doctor, a lawyer, an engineer. Brother singing songs. Brother in prison. Brother selling drugs. She has no future. We are destroyed as a people, and we need God in our lives. In conclusion, Hagar was the handmaiden of Sarah in the Bible. You remember? Sarah was old and she couldn't bear children at that time. So Abraham, the friend of God, went into Hagar and she conceived a child. At some point, Sarah, though old, became pregnant. Now that's a house where there's drama. Heavy drama. Evidently, something happened in the house because, see, a woman don't like competition. Talk to me now. Now, I know in that part of the world, polygamy is the way of life. But a woman who consoles a man doesn't want another woman consoling that man. There's an awful lot of pain in our women
because in their life there's not the kind of man that satisfies the soul. So our women in pain eat and eat and eat and become more and more obese, not because they want to be, but they're hurting. And now they don't care. They're not living for themselves. They don't feel that a man is paying attention to them. Young girls dress in a way to get attention from men, not good attention, but low down attention. But it's attention. When you get children and start losing your form, and you begin not to care for yourself, and no man really paying attention to you, so you feel that, well, the heck with it. I'll just eat and keep on eating. So what if I'm fat? So what if I'm out of shape? I ain't trying to track nobody no way. That's the wrong attitude. You should live for God and for yourself. You don't live for a man. You live for God and you live for yourself. And if there's a good man in your life, you can share the good of your life with him. I say this to you, my sisters, because Hagar was put out of Abraham's house. She's running in the wilderness with a baby, and here's a man that's a prophet and a friend of God. He's in the house. Food is in the house. But the woman that gave him a child is running in the wilderness with no food, looking to the hills for help. And David, the psalmist, says, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills. I think there should be a period there. And then the question is asked, from whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord. So Hagar had a direct connection to God. Because in that wilderness, he fed her, not Abraham. So she then could talk to Abraham as a man like, I know God too. I didn't have to get him through you. I got him in the wilderness, in my pain and in my hunger and in my hurt. God came to me. And every one of you sisters that don't have a man but have a connection to God, you got it all if you know what you got. If you got a connection to him who gave you life, then out of his grace he will give you a man, but don't look for one. Look for God in your life, and the right man will come along. And just ask God to give you the spirit of discernment. I'm ready to go now. I messed up everybody's life. Family, if you look at our women, we are like Hagar, running in the wilderness with our children, looking to the hills for help. And that's why in church, the strongest members are women, because they're trying to find that connection to God through Jesus Christ. I was in a beautiful Baptist church in Houston, And I was talking about women, and I mentioned Mary, the mother of Jesus. And I said to brother, I said, you know, brother, I said, would you honor your mother and honor the mother of Jesus? If she came in the church, would you allow her to come up and speak from the rostrum to the people?
No, she'd have to stand down there.
I said, but brother, she gave you your Savior. Isn't she worthy to give you a message? She's a holy woman. She was a woman that didn't know sin. You mean she can't talk to a house full of sinners? We have messed up religion, and we have literally dishonored God by dishonoring the female. I appeal to us as men. Don't be afraid of an intelligent woman. Be happy that you have an intelligent woman to be your help meet, not a piece of meat, but a help meet to help you meet the obligation that God put on us as men to be cultivators, producers, rulers. A woman by your side when you want to help Christ build the kingdom. She's your helpmeet in that noble idea. But if you're not a kingdom builder, if you just want to, you know, feel good without doing good, then I can tell you that you will have lots of trouble in your home. Because a woman cannot abide a man that is non-productive. And you sisters that take care of men, I'm gonna say it again. Better take a drink of water on that one. You sisters that take care of men, you spoil a man. Any woman that takes care of a man, he's your child. Therefore, you can't honor him in the role that God wants him to play when you've made him your child. And that's why he tells the fellas, come on over to my crib. See, his language tells you where his head is. See, my house is a playpen. Ain't nothing really productive going on there. It's my crib. I got me little toys and whatnot. And when my woman, you know, got some serious business to do, she puts the pacifier in my mouth. And I'm happy as I could be. You spoil him. And you can't love him. Because your nature won't let you love. What can't maintain you, can't protect you, and can't be a doorway for you to Jesus Christ. So when you bring these strange men in your house, and you got these fine-looking young daughters, that at 9 years old, their bosom is bigger than yours, and you think that man is looking at you. Sister, too many of our women have been spoiled by uncles, by fathers, by grandfathers, by brothers, by cousins. And when you despoil a woman, that pain lives until the Redeemer can take it away from her. She can't be made whole after being done like that until God can come into her life and take that away from her. Women, you are the natural protectors of your children, and you must rise up to your job and protect your babies, particularly in a world like this. Your boys, you send them to school, they're smart as they can be from 1 to 5. You send them to school and all of a sudden you see them slipping backward because the educational system of the slave master and his children is a killing field. That's why I'm happy for the apostle and the kingdom school that he set up, because without God in your life, God in the center of your children's life, what do you have? So sisters, I hope that we'll move from Sista to Sister, recognizing God as our Father, and that's what makes you my sister. I want to be a good brother to my sister. When I met Reverend Maxine Walker, I met my sister. And she recognized me, even though my religious name was Muslim. She looked all the way past that. See? And she saw in me her brother. I see Reverend Mitty Collier in the back. That's my sister. And all the pastors, I love you all with all my heart, because I know you have the power to change the reality of human life by good preaching of the gospel and doing everything in your power to live that life. I know we're human and we're filled with frailties and weaknesses, but we should not preach as though we're perfect. We should preach as though we are striving like they are. Because once you set yourself up as being perfect, and then they find a spot or a blemish, like Senator Craig. I am not gay. I don't do those things. But Lord, they're killing and crucifying that man. So we who are in leadership should strive to be the best examples that we could be and ask God's forgiveness for our shortcomings. But in the Christ, you call him Christ, and that's his title. His name is Jesus. In the Quran, we see Jesus as the Messiah, as the presence of God among human beings. This is the way we see him. But we don't see him as an unattainable object. We see him as an example for us. So we try to rise to be like him. See? I strive to be like him. That's why I'm hated. If you're not hated, check yourself. Because the master was hated, and he said his disciples will be hated for his name's sake. They don't write bad about nobody like they write about me. See, but you know, it's all right with me. Because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. They can't destroy the God that is within me. So he's making a man out of me. So I challenge the government. Why? Because I know God. I'm not somebody trying to find him. I know he's my backup. I know he's my strength.
I don't talk like the psalmist say, the Lord is my strength and he is my salvation. Of whom then shall I be afraid? Get up like a man of God and preach this gospel without fear, and let God uphold you. He can't uphold you doing nothing. Challenge the world and let's bring in the kingdom. This world is not worthy of us. Let's bring in the kingdom. When they send for you to send your children to die in Iraq, tell them, not my child. Stand up. Not my child. I'll go to the draft board. Not my sons. You won't take one of them to send them to die in your wickedness. I'm a kingdom man. See, and if that frightens you, you ain't a kingdom woman. Are you still Sista? May God bless us. Thank you for listening. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.